All right, ladies and gentlemen, Bob DiNatelli.
Thing 1 2 3. Is that working now? Okay. Well, thank you for that. That's, please turn it up. Sure, I'll try if I can. How about that? Testing 1 2 3. Mechanical and technical kind of guy. Ben will take care of that. I'm sure that applause was for maybe you attended my Nikon school back in 1970s plus at San Francisco. There's some people here who've been to a Nikon school, I bet. You've been before digital, long before digital. Well, yes, please, if you could turn the lights down. I think, although, yeah, well, I'm getting pretty loud now. I'm getting feedback, huh?
Here's, I think this one is you.
You think the one that says speech is me?
The one that says speech is you. Don't mute.
Oh, no, 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 yeah. And go down. Okay, well, we'll see what happens. I can talk loud. Boy, I feel very special to be doing this talk at Adobe. I'm Adobe certified, you know, been since Lightroom 1 or 2, I don't know. And I really feel, you know, that I need to do my best Lightroom stuff tonight as far as trying to explain what I do. So I'm going to try to talk while I move my hands. Now, being a Sicilian, that's not a problem. Being from Boston, maybe a little accent issue, but I have photos up here. Take a look at them when you get a chance. They may mean more to you after this, because someone made mention of this image here, the sand dunes, and one of these here you'll have to take a look at. 10,000 ISO, there's a couple of 10,000 ISOs up here. From my half-frame camera, if anybody's, which is the Lumix GH3, had the GH1 went to the 3. But anyways, I hope, want you to take some notes, pencil, paper, tablet, whatever, but I made a page for this, so try to take your notes, ask your questions. I'll answer them as we go. If I think I'm going to answer them later, please let me have the feature doing it. This is the site. This is, and I'll talk obviously a lot about my One Zone book, because that's what I'm going to talk about, the optimum digital exposure. But One Zone is the only thing we need to expose. Get the brightest part at 99% brightness in Lightroom when you shoot, and everything will fall where it's going to fall, depending on the dynamic range. So the book has this One Zone method, thus the onezone.photos/, you guys know it, right? Let me see, it's the S, San Francisco, oh, Lightroom User Group. I didn't put the B in there, so it's San Francisco Lightroom User Group. And on there will be links to the One Zone photo page, some of the class slides, my article on luminous landscape, a couple of important papers on exposure by Bruce Fraser. I'm going to talk about the four phases of digital photography, and we'll talk about the other stuff later. So there's a page up there that will cover a lot of the notes, hopefully. I'm running, obviously, you see this whole thing off of Lightroom. Tonight, I'm going to give away maybe like 3 books, maybe some questions or a good question, and a color checker passport. Does anybody know what a color checker passport is from X-Rite? A few of you do? Okay, great. We'll talk a little bit about that. But I think that's about it. I think we should, you know, this is an overview. It's trying to bring an awareness to exposure. It's not, obviously not a class. And we'll try to maybe give an awareness, and hopefully the talk will be a basis for a better understanding. This has very little to do with the talk, but back in Cambridge about Harvard Square maybe 10 years ago, I got cornered in a room at a Sufi meeting, and they were talking about the seven levels of awareness. And the fifth level was wisdom. And I thought, gee, 5 out of 7, I'm there already. How hard can this all be? And then they said the sixth level was divine wisdom. Sounded like semantics to me. And what does that mean? It means applying the wisdom that you have. So I know where I fell off the tracks, right? So all of us know a lot about digital photography. Some of it real valid, some of it mixed messages on the internet, but we may know a lot. I'm going to try to see if this idea that I put together in the book is the optimum digital exposure. And of course, as photographers, what do? We put light on film. We put light on sensors now. And it's controlling that light. I made a few questions here, just so I could get a handle on maybe the experience level or just the backgrounds here. How many people have been in a wet dark room? Oh, nice, great. Anybody in a color dark room? Cibachrome? An easy way to. How many people output the print? Is it mostly on the web, mostly on your websites, or social media, or how many people print? Oh, it's great. That's great. Do you print yourself or a service bureau? Yourself? Both. And you go to a service bureau. Yeah, good. And Lightroom has so much power with its soft proofing and its exporting. One last thing, because I've got this in two methodologies, one using a spot meter and one using your camera meter, although you could use the spot and the camera meter, but I make mention of that in the book. There are a lot of people go out to the mountains with a spot meter anymore. Anybody go out there? No, just your camera, your matrix metering probably, huh? That's what we're doing. Okay, good. All right, I get an idea, but a little, you know, understanding photography, there's a whole bunch, right? There is metering, there is lens utilization, your depth of field, perspective, how to use lenses, light. Of all of these things, tonight we're going to focus on exposure. And has anybody heard the term exposure trio? I think Mark Johnson or somebody uses that. It was a great thing. The exposure trio, this is all about photography. F-stop, shutter speed, and ISO. How much light do you need to put on, and what are your two tools? Now, you have to understand this is about raw, and these are the only three elements that are locked in a raw file. Everything else is up for fair game. Your f-stop will control the depth of field or force you to use a shutter speed that may be too slow. And the ISO, then who cares? Because we can always bump up the ISO to 100, 200, 400, 1600. Where is my 10,000 ISO? And you can do this with today's sensors and with today's software like Lightroom. Now, I can't make any bones about getting it right in the camera. And I'm talking about exposure. But I'm telling you, if you don't have the decisive moment, you know, Cartier-Bresson does that. If you don't capture the moment, exposure doesn't make a whole heck of a lot of difference. So we can do an awful lot in Photoshop. We're getting to do more and more in Lightroom. But I'm going to talk about the craft of photography. And by doing that, I do not want to demean the importance of capturing the moment in the camera. I bring that up because in talks people say, yeah, but you said nothing about taking pictures. Look at this is not what this is about. We either have a sensitivity or we can work on it. So I need to bring that up. Now, the book will talk about this. It's in PDF form. It's up on Amazon. I'll give a few away tonight. Maybe I'll start here. When we talk about light, there's two kinds of light. There's the incident light that's falling on us, and then the reflected light that bounces off of us. Okay, so the light that hits me is incident, and what bounces off to you is the reflected light. And therefore, we have two kinds of exposure meters. We have an incident meter that's reading the light value. I'm not going to get fooled with a black cat or a white snowbank. It doesn't see that. Then there is the reflective type of light meters that's actually reading the subject. And that's what's in our camera. So we're dealing with reflected light. And this can be a problem. Because does everybody know? It doesn't matter which one. Do you know what they're set for? Yeah, 18% gray. That's kind of almost right. People don't tell us. Nikon and Canon, they don't tell us. It's more like 12 or 14%. Interesting link. Maybe I don't think I put it on the page, but debunking 18%. Ansel Adams kind of twisted Kodak's arm on this way back when. And so, does anybody know why 18% is in the middle? It's a book. It's the first book, though. Anybody know why 18% is in the middle? Doesn't that seem strange? Okay. I can do this in techno's country. Geometric means. Think about the geometric mean here. The darkest anything can be, and photographers usually reference black velvet. You know, it just absorbs a lot of the light, but it doesn't absorb everything. It reflects about 4% of the light. And the brightest white we have, the brightest white paper, is about 90%. Geometric mean, it's a book. Okay. Are we getting close to the geometric mean? If you take the extremes, the darkest being 4% and the brightest being 90%, that's 360. The square root is the geometric mean. And so 18 is in the middle because it's 4, 8, 16, 32, 64. There can't be 128 brightness. Well, you're the only one who said 18%, so take this one. Okay, but it's kind of cool. And by the way, that fits in Ansel Adams' idea. And Kodak didn't buy into this at all. But he twisted their arm, and it works very well. So let's get into a little bit of the optimum exposure and why the optimum exposure is critical. I'm going to put up a few bullet points here. And there can be some gasps if you want. But 10% of the image is done in the camera. The other 90% is done in the software. Does that shock anybody? Shock me. The digital camera sensor sees in linear mode, not like film. You doubled the geometric progression. It's linear. We're gonna talk all about these. And your captured raw data is far from linear. Let's go here first. I'm saying 10% of the raw data is captured by the camera. So those are the bright points. And your software makes up the other 90%. I think exposure is critical because if I missed exposure, I only have 10% to start off with. Think about this. Your camera, most of them are 12 bits. Your Nikons, the big 8800s, and the Mark 4s, 3s, 5s, but they could be 14-bit. Although I read somewhere where there's 14-bit, but they use 13 bits, and another bit is used for something else. I don't quite know. But most of us are dealing with a 12-bit. So if it produces 4,009 shades, Lightroom is 16-bit. You open up these 4,000 shades, and it produces 65,000 shades. Or your raw data makes about 61,000 of the 65,000. So I think it's critical. By the way, up on the site, I'll put it up there again so you can make sure you get the, I do have the final build of all these slides up there. Can click on them and use that for review if you want. What's important to know is Lightroom or Photoshop, neither Lightroom or Photoshop, it's ACR, it's Adobe Camera Raw engine in there. And it's very, very smart. It has adaptive technology. It can take very little data, 10%, and make a lot of data. And it does it with adaptive technology, which is very smart the way it makes it. And you have to know, once you bring it in and it makes it, every adjustment you make, it's digging into this data and making more good data. So capturing it is very, very critical. I say later on, and I'll show you, that you'll get sharper images with the optimum digital exposure because you're dealing with more data. So if you capture, in the little small data here is to imply you missed your exposure, it wasn't optimum. Well, that's all right. Adobe Camera Raw is going to make the 65,000, except it's not going to be the same quality of data. And as you make adjustments, it never gets any better. So it's very, very critical to make that optimum exposure. Now, a lot of people probably think that they do okay with their exposures. And because of the software, because of the cameras and the noise reduction, and this is all based on, we're assuming RAW here, you can come up with a good picture with a not optimum exposure. But that's not what we're talking about here. We're trying to get the optimum exposure for the optimum image. Let's look at this for a second. Your camera, your digital camera, reads light linearly. So if you have 4,096 shades, because it's a 12-bit camera, if you miss your exposure by one stop, you've lost 50% of your data. One stop is 50% of your data. No, just under. Over is lost. Our challenge is to put it up as far to the right as we can without going over. And I'll show you examples of that. If you miss it by two stops, you've lost 75% of your data. You've only captured 25% of what was in front of you. Well, I know that's impossible because nobody's that bad to make two stops underexposed. I didn't say two stops underexposed. Two stops away from optimum. Your normal exposure, the 18% gray, is underexposed by the nature of the camera. Okay? So there are a couple of, Bruce Fraser, if anybody ever saw him talk, he's passed now, unfortunately, at too young of an age. He has two wonderful papers, Raw Capture, Linear, Gamma. And you can see, by the way, the curve is there. And Understanding Digital Raw Capture. Go to the page. I've got a link to the PDF. Four pages. Each one of them are four pages. Enough said, you need to look no further than Bruce's papers. Now you can see, oh, I think somewhere here I had a, Bruce is showing you what that linear sensor is producing, far from linear. So, in my book, kind of the principle that I have for the exposure is to say, I'm an empirical kind of guy. That test is in here, and it's called the empirical proof test. People say, Bob, I don't agree with you. I don't, it's okay, you don't have to agree with me. Did you try it? No, but everything I read says, why don't you try it and help me kick the can further down the road here? You know what I mean? Don't just say, you know, I've read too much saying that's not the case. Well, you haven't read enough. And by the way, not that my book is definitive. I think the biggest value of this book is the references. Let's just see George Jardine write about this. Talk about Michael Reichman and all the links. And of course, in the PDF form, it's great because you can just get the PDF and click on it. And what you'll notice, if you run that test, what I'm showing at the bottom here, it's a very simple test. You know, I wrote the article for Luminous Landscape called The Optimum Digital Exposure. About a week and a half ago, someone wrote an article called A Precise Digital Exposure. So one of my friends says, about the second sentence was, I read an article here a couple of months ago, and quite honestly, the author brought nothing new to the table. So my friend Frank said, Bob, are they talking about you? I says, I think he is, yes. And all I say is I'm an empirical kind of guy. I work for Polaroid in R&D. And procedures are not there to govern you. Procedures are there to develop systems to set you free. And so this is as simple as the day is long. You meet a white card or a gray card. If I meet it, this is a white card. But of course, the meter is going to make it gray. That's what a meter does. And if you open it up a third of a stop, I don't know what that means, but it'll be a third of a stop lighter than mid-tone gray. Another third, another third, another third. And eventually, it's going to stay white. And that's where the optimum exposure is. So with this little procedure I have in there, it comes with a little chart and says, if you shoot something at 0, plus 1 third, plus 2 thirds, just write the values down in here. And you'll notice that the first stop is going to give you about 50%, 57, 54. Don't be alarmed that it's not 50. But what's interesting is the second stop will bring you around 72. The third stop, up around 90% brightness. The next stop is about 97, and the next stop is 99. What does this show you? Very critical here. That 99, that's just before Lightroom turns red, huh? the clipping warning, it says 99, and it's easy. All you have to do is shoot this test and leave your bet and go and see which one. It says, three and two thirds stops. Well, that's it. Just set that on your meter and you're fine. That is the optimal white point. You want to get the brightest part of the scene at 99%. The dynamic range will then just let the rest of the scene fall where it needs to be. What you should know is this. Remember, half is 50%. The top 50% of your exposure lives on the top 3% of your file. Think about this. The top 50% of the data, half of the data, resides from 97 to 99%, 96, 99. The second stop, the first two stops, fall between about 90 and 99%. Okay, let's put this puzzle together. That means if the brightness value in your Lightroom file, open it up, go run the little cursor around. If it's 90%, you have underexposed by two stops. 90%. I bet you there's 80% of your photos don't have 90% in them. That means if I took a picture of you here, and as dark as this is, this room, I need to expose it so the brightest part, let's just say the screen tablet that you're holding, right? Just make that be 99%. Now, all of you guys are going to be just very bright, but when I run the slider down, am I going to have detail? Am I going to have less noise? Am I going to have more sharpness? That's pretty critical. Looking at this scene looks pretty good. I'm running Lightroom here. Let me just go into this for a second. And I'm going to go into the develop mode. And you know, when I run over this, we see RGB values up here. It's not quite RGB. It's kind of like lab color. Well, you know, if you right mouse click over here, you can show the lab color values. So if I shut them off, everybody's seeing the red, green, blue. Red, green, blue means nothing to me. I'm not memorizing the 33% green, 14% blue, and 12% red is the color of Adobe's badge. What's important to me is the lightness value. So you'll see that I'll just run lightness values through here. When I go here, I'm guessing his pants. Look at his pants. 76%, it's about three stops underexposed. Three stops underexposed. This is probably where it needs to be. Even 90, it says, but there may be some there. But what I wanted to point out to you is that no way could I ever miss my be underexposed by two stops. I'm not saying it underexposed, because metering a gray card, metering the subject is underexposed. It just has to be. It's not optimal. Nobody wants to get optimum, because then I have to adjust every one of them. Well, if I want to make a 10,000 ISO 12 by 12 print, I can do this. So let's continue on. This is Lightroom CC, by the way. All right, so I'm going to wrap up this little thing with 10% of our data, and I'm filling this out. Remember, Lightroom and ACR, very, very smart. Capture raw data. The captured raw data is not linear. And, of course, this, if the brightest value is 99%, and this all assumes... It all assumes optimum exposure. Just remember that this slide is up on the site, so you can take notes or look at it later on. Something slowed up when I went back to Lightroom. Okay, what are the benefits of optimum exposure? Well, there's going to be less noise. Why? Because you're exposing to the right. That's primitive. But originally, exposure to the right was intended to get away from the noisy chips of 6-7 years ago. Now there's algorithms and processing, but see, the idea of shooting JPEG, the camera processes for you. It'll do delighting, it'll adjust for contrast, but it's done. It's processing it, you don't have a lot. Excuse me, I think that was the pizza that just came up. Less noise, sharper images, more tonal data, and less processing artifacts. I'm going to show you a few of these. This is an ISO 800. Can I do this? Sure, because I have. This is what one would expect to see with ISO 800. See if I can get it back down here. Get it back up. See if I can get it back in here, okay? Now, if I was to shoot at 200 ISO, there is no doubts that there is a big difference between 200 ISO and 800 ISO. One would agree. I mean, it's pretty obvious, right? I'm going to go back here just so I can square it back up and get it up to 100%. Go back to E. Okay. You go back to Z. Now, here's the surprising thing. If you go up to 800 and put the exposure way to the optimum brightness, you're going to see that 800 ISO at optimum is very similar to 200 ISO normal. I gotta get some gasps. That doesn't surprise anybody. It surprised the hell out of me. And when I go here to the next picture that I'm going to show you, the website, things are going a little slowly here. Okay. And if I'm going here, there are Shopee images. Can you see the difference in your hair? One was shot at 200 ISO, one was shot at 800 ISO, but optimum. I'm going to go here. Part of what's on the book has a website. And there is a page, because I knew you couldn't see all this in the printed book. So I found this little, look at the camera at 800 ISO. And this is the 200 ISO, but yet this on the right is the optimum at 800. Is that clear? Does everybody see what's happening? Because people say to me, if you want me to expose up there, I have to open up my shutter speed. Two shutter speeds slower, and I'm going to get a blurry picture. And of course, but if you go to higher ISOs, it'll be the same speed. I can't do that. My camera's too noisy. Your camera's not noisy. You just left 25% of your data in the scene. And look at this. This is her here on the normal exposure. Look at the sharpness here. Because this smart adaptive algorithm in Lightroom or Adobe Camera Raw can do some magic things. You feed it 200% more data, it's going to make great data. And every time you shift it, I find myself not stopping at 40% or 40 on the sharpening. I'm up at 66. I'll go to 80 if I need to. I don't see the artifacts that I saw before. I started to get chipping when I got to, 35, 45. You'd see the little crust at the end on the edges, right? Yeah, it's a big difference. Big, big difference. Let's go to the next one. And I think what I'm going to do is, that was my little sign to go there. So any questions at this point? I mean, is it just too complex or is it just making all kinds of sense? Because those usually fall in the same silence. See, I keep saying when I do this, do you understand the theory of relativity? Oh yeah, this goes this and it goes very fast, yeah. When I've lectured a lot and people say, I'm confused. I say, rejoice in your confusion because you must be getting close, because if you weren't close, you wouldn't be confused. So don't feel as though you need to get. If it didn't work, don't mention it. Okay. I'm going to give you two methods to deal with that. And please ask the questions from the floor. And if I don't have them answered here, I'll answer them. Let's talk about exposure.
Can you repeat the question as well?
Excuse me?
Can you repeat the question? Just because we can all hear the question.
He said that he tried my exposure the other night and it's the best thing he ever had in his life. And nothing more need be said. That's it. He's doing tomorrow's lecture. He said he was getting spectral flare and, and let's talk about exposure here. And this may be giving you a good idea. Now, we talked about the decisive moment. And something's moving a little too slowly here. And that probably is good. It'll give me a governor. Exposure. When we're looking at exposure, what are we talking about? The final exposure? Or are we looking at the proper exposure? What's the proper exposure for a white rabbit? It's gotta be white. The black cat in the coal bin has to be black. This is the badge photographers wear. I know that this is a dark subject. I have to close down my lens. I know this is a bright subject. We all know going on the ski slopes or the beach, right? Everything's underexposed. Why is it so dark? Because it's so bright. And the meter wants to bring everything neutral. Are these the same? No, they're far from the same. Remember we talked about, people say, well, I used to get it right when I did black and white negatives. No, it's not what you saw. This is reverse, it's not contrast, it's a negative. And people say, that print is just the way I saw it. I put it right on that negative. With digital, it's like slide film, it's positive. So when we look at this white rabbit, you know what I'm gonna do? I'm gonna go through these things, but they need to go a little fast. So watch what I'm gonna do here. I'm gonna escape. I'm gonna try to escape. Something's working very slowly here. Ever since I went
I think you're in the develop module.
Excuse me?
Are you in the develop module, not the slideshow module? So
no, you know what I think? It seemed to just happen. It seemed to just happen when I hit the when I went to the web. You know? So I'm trying to see if I can do this. Now watch how wonderful Lightroom is. If I say, I want to close this. Oh, look at it, it's not even getting out of this mode. Hang on for a second. Decide I can't even hit escape or quit. Okay. You know, I just feel so comfortable with this closed window. Lightroom's gone. See if I can get it back up here. Right at the same place. Isn't life wonderful? Okay, let's go back up here, see if it gets a little faster. It may be because we're also recording this. So, thank you very much. Thank you guys for picking that up. Let's see what happens here with the F mode. Aha. See? Collective minds. We've kicked the can further. Well, we know from our talk before, that when we look at this, there you go. Thank you very much. That was it. We know that everything is made for 18%. So when we look at the rabbit, and the camera wants to get it to gray, trust me, the camera will get it to gray. That's all it sees. This is called subject failure. You point at a bright scene, it comes out dark. You point at a dark scene, like the black cat in a coal bin. And again, it's going to try to bring it to gray. Matter of fact, that reflective meter, the only time the exposure is correct is when you take pictures of gray cards. everything else is something else, you know? And this is called subject failure. Now, the proper exposure is what all of us photographers had to do with slide film. There was no other chance. Of course, with negatives, we made our negatives as thin as possible, so you could get more detail, and then you got out of the print. But the question now is, what about the optimum exposure? Well, we're talking digital now, and that means you need to be doing RAW. You're capturing RAW, and the white rabbit is even whiter. Looks a little blown out, like you were mentioning to it, and this is going to surprise a lot of you, but that's the optimum exposure for a black cat. It should look like the white rabbit. Matter of fact, on an overcast day, it's a very flat subject, huh? You can open that up two or three stops and you still haven't gone off the edge of your histogram. When you're in a black cat in a coal bin here, it's not a great dynamic range. This is the optimum exposure. That's when we talk exposure to the right. this idea of trying to move your data down the histogram without going over the histogram is our intent. How far right? What's the optimum? As far right as you can go without going over, and that's that 99% rightness, that optimum white point. If you could meter off the rump of this rabbit here and put it at 99%, there is nothing brighter than that back end of his body. 99%. Oops. If I was to meter off the brightest part of the scene and put that at 99%, it never lost it in the histogram. That is the optimum exposure. So the question now comes, where is the final exposure? The final exposure is in your processing software, where you have the most data to now adjust. Make sense? Any questions? You had a question? Did that make sense? Boy, I'm either very good or I'm it's no, please. I'm just, yeah, I'll take it. But let me know. Yes, sir. Yeah, kind of. You read the article, not the book. Okay, I'll tell you what's in the book. You don't even have to buy the book. The final exposure, you know, if I read this, that's what it would be. I need to put it as far right as I can. Look at this image afterwards. You guys are going to have to come up and take a look at this image. It just is black, and all the tones of white that you could possibly, nothing is blown out over here. It just looks like it's blown out. And that's what it ends up looking like. The needed exposure. Does anybody know this building? I call it the Black Globe building. It's down, this is Jackson? Yeah, well, tell me next time, because I know it's here. So here's the optimum exposure, and then the final exposure. Has anybody heard about exposure to the left? Well, you should be, your slider and your software should be exposing to the left, or else you buried it too far down in the file and you're dragging it up. And you look at how many files you have in Lightroom that has a plus exposure value. You missed your exposure. It's great pictures, but it's not optimum. Yes, sir. Yes. Okay, that's a good point. He's asking about the histogram. It looks terrible in the back of the camera. That's only because it's terrible on the back of the camera. It's not good in your software, but it's not terrible. You'll have to make it darker. And I'm going to show you the difference between the blinkies and the back of your camera and the histogram. That histogram is a JPEG histogram. It has nothing to do with your raw data. Okay, so let me move along here, and I'll just say you here. If I could read that, you're going to need a spot meter. And your question was, how do you do that very fast? Well, you don't get fast moving. You get a still rabbit and a still, you can't get still grandchildren yet, but we'll deal with that. So basically, you just read off the brightest part. And through that little test, you will know the 3.5 stops falls at 99% brightness. Look at it's nothing. I have a U.S. patent in color printing. And the basis is to get gray. I don't know how, it's not a great revelation. If you get gray, then light pink is gonna be light pink, or light pink the way Kodachrome makes light pink, because it doesn't make it the same way Ektachrome or Fuji, and you know. So this is a very simple approach. It's empirical. People have said to me, well, Bob, you don't know the delta E or whatever's happening up on the Nikon when those are the -4 base value. I only know that I've just exposed my gray card or my white card. I know 3.3 3 2/3 stops gets me to 99. I can go here, take a metering, take a shot, put it in, and it'll be 99% brightness. That's total control. Spot meter, the brightest part, and here it was the brightest part of the O, and the final exposure is in the camera. Dave, what was your name? Dave. Is that practical? Is that practical? Well, absolutely. It's absolutely, if you're just taking pictures of churches and falling barns, as long as it's not falling. But what about not cats and rabbits? It's not good for cats, rabbits, grandkids, and street saints. So here is a modified one zone approach. And this is what I would ask everybody to try. Yeah, my email's up there. I've got some wonderful testimonials for people who've been shooting a long time. I want you to bracket your exposure in 2/3 of the stop. And I want to send the base exposure to 1 1/3. Watch what happens here. The resulting set is, if you set for 1 1/3 minus 2/3 would be 2/3, plus 2/3 would be 2. You have a bracket set that's going from 2/3 to 2 stops over. There's not a meter out there that's going to go over the histogram at a plus 2/3 of a stop. It's safe. It's really safe. And what I do is, as you can see here, when I get these exposures, now they look pretty light, huh? But this one, you can see, is 1 1/3, 2/3, and a plus 2. You can see the blinkies on the camera, right? The black blinkies on the camera, you were asking. And you can see here that at the normal exposure, there was blinkies up on the face. Here, there were none. Why? Because it's 2/3 of a stop background. But let me tell you, this is underexposed by at least a stop and a half. This picture is underexposed by a stop and a half. Look at this one. This has more blinkies. So when you look at these, I want you to go into your camera and set the sequence, if your camera can do this. So it's 0 first, then minus and plus. So I just make sure there's, because that's your base exposure. Then you have another one that's lighter and darker. And what I do is, I go to my custom mode, I go ahead and put it in custom mode. I put it in custom mode 2 now, because that's method number 2. And method number 1 is for when I do manual exposures. And you'll get this kind of results. And look at the blinkies. The blinkies will occur. But what you need to know is that the blinkies occur about a stop before the red highlights in Lightroom. It's about a stop before. And you can, on that empirical test, it says, before you put this in your camera or put this in your software, look in the back of your camera. Where did the blinky start? 2.5 stops overexposed, the blinky started. Go with the Lightroom. When did the red lights come on? Oh, about 3, 3.5. If you don't have blinkies on any of these, if you have blinkies on one of them, you've got the right exposure. If you have blinkies on two of them, of your brackets, you've got the right exposure, because you don't want to not have blinkies. That's just very bad. What you should know is this. The exposure is not always going to be the first one. Sometimes it'll be the second one. Sometimes it'll be the third one. Why? Because of subject failure. When you point at a bright subject, I'm telling you, you're going to be plus 2 all the time. I said, how can I be 2 stops overexposed? No, you were 2 stops underexposed when you pointed it to the white rabbit, to the white snow cap. But don't want you to confuse proper exposure with optimum exposure. So if you're out in the beach and you know you're going to be underexposed or you're in the night, again, just let that multi-zone metering, I have to say multi-zone because who calls it matrix, who calls it this? It's very smart. And then by bracketing this, you will come up with one of the three exposures. I'm going to show you some now over the next few minutes. I bring this up because one of the other things I do, this is going to shock you folks, but what should take the shock away when the lights go on and you look at some of these prints, I also set my auto exposure, my exposure to auto ISO. Auto ISO. That means when I bracket, sometimes it's a 60th of a second at a 2,000, a 60th of a second at a 4,000, and a 60th of a second at an 8,000. Now, I think you know I didn't take this picture. My five-year-old grandson at the birthday, because he sees me with the camera, he says, Babo, can I take a picture of you? Yeah. Good thing I have the GH3. He's like this, trying to hold it up. And I said, he knows now. When you take the picture, Aaron, hold it down till you hear the three clicks. Not one, and then the next picture you take is, he goes like this. This is it, 10,000 ISO. It's about 5 o'clock at night in April in the front room with only lights on. You want to look at the grain or the lack of it here. It was way, way to the right. Nice and flat, way to the right. Going to show a few things right now. We have about 10 minutes. I'll go through a couple of these so you get an idea. Any general questions? Because I think that's it. Now I just want to process a few things and show you. Yes, sir. Oh, you're at the beach, and the subject you're taking is on the bright sand. Oh, no, no, they were under the dark umbrella, and they waited to go under the tree. Well, but this method two, what I'm calling method two, says, show me what you got. Your matrix metering is pretty smart. It's not going to get fooled. It'll just be wrong because it's going to try to bring everything to 18 or more like 12 or 14%. Now, if it sees this bright thing, you'll find plus two stops at the beach will still not even give you blinkies in your camera. Someone else had a question? Yes. What was that again, please? No, no, no. Whatever, look at whatever noise you're getting is the best of the least noise you could get because you're getting it far away. And by the way, I don't have to worry about that. Dave doesn't want me to shoot the spot meter all the time. Because if it could, I could drop it right on dime. I could drop the white point on 99%. And now when Aaron picks up my camera and shoots it, the best of my Siconic L758, but you know, I understand. I use zone one, that zone method one, more for validation. Because I just have to say, yep, Bob, you can still control it. Yes, you do. 95% of my other shots are using the bracket. Now, if you think about that, someone's going to say, nice job, Bob. But I think when I went out and took 11 pictures, come on, wake up, little mouse. I think when I went out and took 11 pictures, how the hell did I end up with 33? Bracket, of course. Not really good. However, the power of Lightroom on the website for the book. So again, there's a lot of information. You don't have to buy the book. Go to our page, go to the site, look at the videos. It'll explain to what I'm saying here. Does anybody use the stacking feature? Sure. Do you auto stack by time? How many auto stack by time? Very good. That's good. Watch what happens here. These are the exposures, 1, 2, and 3. So you can see that 1, 2. You can see up here that I've had this displaying. The Lumix doesn't say 66 hundredths. It's 30/50. Don't ask me why, but that's how they say 2/3. Okay, so this looks pretty bright, huh? However, follow this. Right mouse click any place, and there is a stacking. And it says auto stack by time. In other words, if you wanted to capture everything that you shot in 46 seconds, that's not what I want to do. You want to go down here to 1 second because your brackets, you can use this with that. I want to stack anything that happens within a second. Matter of fact, well, this may be crazy, I went to my slower burst mode so I could get different facial expressions because they were so fast that it was the exact same thing. But watch this. If I say stack by time, do you notice this is 1 of 3? This is 1 of 3? Because they all fell within the second. If you right mouse click, stacking, collapse all stacks, then a little action will be really nice. I get to do actions in Lightroom, like Photoshop. There's my 11 pictures. So you don't have to clutter yourself. But what do you do, Bob? Well, look at it. I'm just going to go into, let me take this first one here. I'll just do a couple, then I'll open for probably more question and answers. If I go into the develop mode, and does everybody know that this turns on the red warning light? You know, or the letter J does the same thing. This has no red lights, right? So when you think about this, you don't have to exhaust yourself in saying, how do I look through all these pictures? If I was to go here and say, well, if I'm seeing no blinkies here, if I open this stack, I don't have to look at the one that's 2/3 of a stop underexposed. God, if I didn't have blinkies here, I'm not having blinkies in the dark one. Let me go over to here. You see? So you just take all your images, you stack them by time, and you look at it. I'm not going to open up half of my images. I don't save 30% of my images, right? And when I do, I say, oh, this is pretty good. Now, somebody may say, that's overexposed. Well, wait a minute. Because if you have white or specular highlights, you should be seeing red, right? And I think this is just fine. So what I'm going to do is watch this one. You see this here? See this badge that says 3 of 3? When I click it, it goes to the front of the stack. I click the front of the stack, it collapses. That's the only one I want. You can download from my site a filter that says delete everything that doesn't have a flag on it. So now that's how I clean up when I'm done with my shoot. I say, look it, I'm going to flag this one. I'm not sure if I'm going to use it, but it's one. And then I can clean up at least 2/3 of all my pictures like this. So now I want to explain to you, we're doing pretty good. It's about 3:08. I'm going to do 1 or 2 examples and then we'll ask a few questions and whatever. On the site, our site, this is where you'll find the slides. They're up in Smug Mug. You'll be able to see them. Let me go back here. This is how you can go to the OneZone site. This is the Luminous Landscape article. Boy, guys, I don't know. Just I hope you're enjoying this or finding this informative. I'd love to come back sometime and do one on the 4 phases of processing. Click on this for a second when you get home. I have a blog post. Watch how I'm going to process 2 images here. And then we'll go for the questions. Watch this. The very first thing Now, the first thing you may want to do is white balance. You're kind of like, it used to be that they talked about going from the top down because it was like a nice idea. It's the only idea in Lightroom Process version 2012. It's adaptive technology that works from the top down. You cannot take your blacks first and go up to your shadows, then go to your exposure. You can make a nice picture. You're not optimizing it. It is intended to work from the top down. And white balance will change that value. So if I have something, if I click on this white, it says, I can't do it, it's too bright. Well, we have a gray walkway here. I'll click on a gray walkway. Now, I don't know if anybody saw the difference here. It was a subtle difference. When you click on the white balance, it's a suggestion. It's not saying this is what should be, but it gives you an idea where it's going. And I just bring it up because white point does affect it. Now, follow this concept. This is really important. And then maybe in some of the Q&As, you want to jump in and talk about this. I know I've talked with Jeff Shuey and Eric Chan, and I know you press auto tone. Now, when you press auto tone, I want you to notice what happened here. See the exposure minus 50, 3. Anybody remember the black and white negatives, the S curve, the little shape of the S curve? I like to think this is Lightroom's S curves. Look at this. And every picture is going to be different. Now, from Lightroom Process version 2010 to 2012, the autotone doesn't work as well as it did with Lightroom 4. Came out with Process version 2012. You could hit that, you could import with autotone and you'd get the right exposure. This doesn't, but you get the optimum. This is the relationship that Tondo and Eric Chan wants. Now, work from the top down. The very first thing I do is I grab the exposure. If I want, I can now everything I want you to do now is touchy-feely. It's really interpretive. But the first thing I want you to do is white balance, autotone, or autotone and white balance if you can get a white balance. Now when you do this, if I bring up the shadows, I can get more in the shadows. I can do a lot of things here. I can bring my highlights if this bothers you, this bright light over here. Get this white paper, it doesn't like that. So if I wanted to, I could bring down the highlights. Jack Davis, so quite another nice, good teacher. If you ever see anything done by Jack Davis, he used to call this the four-step tango. Well, now it's a five-step. We have an extra slider. But I want you to think of the tango because you're going to come down here. You're going to just trim back the whites. No, you may go back up here. You may take the contrast down to open it up. You see how the contrast can nice and open it up? If I hit the alternate key or the option key, you know I can always find my black. And here is where I'll bring up the clarity a little. I should be looking at this to see what it is. And now I'm going to show you a sharpener. I have a sharpen algorithm. But when I do this, I want you to see. I want you to see what my values are here. This is like my default sharpening, 66, 1, and 50. I couldn't do this with Process version 2010 and not with exposure, not optimum exposure. Take a look at this one here. I'm going to go back here to this set. It's 8 o'clock, so I'm going to just do one or two or another here. But this is important for the mantra. The exposure, optimum exposure, I hope I got it across. We'll ask some questions. But when you do, now we're starting to play. And you're playing with all the richness that your camera could capture. So if I look at this, all I have to do is go into develop. I can look at this one. Let me zoom back. Well, if this is the first exposure, doesn't this tell you that I don't need to be looking at the third exposure? This is going to be a disaster. Correct? So really, if you think this one here is a little light, take this one. And when you take this one, we're going to try to salvage the outside. So again, the mantra is, the exposure is all done. Here was a shotgun approach. I'm taking the best from the bunch, and then I'm hitting auto tone. And then I might try a white balance here, but of course I'm under tungsten lights, and I think that looks too bad. I may pick another white point, like maybe my computer. I'll do that with the warm color. That's good enough for now. We can always. Now watch. Here comes the exposure. Now, when I go down like this, I'm bringing the cable car in the back. I may go a little more. And if I go a little more, we're going to say, yes, but we look at how we're losing this. Oh, I have a lot of data there. Wait till I start the shadow key. You know, because now I've got tremendous data there. So I'll go here, I'll take the highlight down, and I'll come back here to the shadows. And when I open this back up, I have a tremendous amount of data here. So when I dragged it down, that was just for an overall. Now I'm going in, the first phase of processing is importing. You should sharpen there. You should put your camera calibration there. Do a lot of things there. The second phase is global, and the third phase is selective. So if I do this, I'm going to put a gradient here. Okay. Now, by the way, do you know if you hold the alternate key down, you can reset? So if I was to do this, there's a couple of ways you can reset. You can double click on the name. Oops, I can keep the hands. Or if you hold the alternate key or the option key down, the effect says reset. So now what I want to do is I want to bring some exposure here. Not too much exposure here. I'm going to come back here with my shadows and very selectively go back up here. Now here's something I do. I'll lower the contrast, and you'll see that. You see that come in when I lower the contrast? And so if I just go back up here a little bit, and now if I use the clarity is like an edge sharpness. Look at the back wall behind this man on the left here. Sometimes this combination of contrast down, things just open up. And then we're going to go ahead with the, sounds like a phone. Okay, so you see, and again, if I went into my selective, when I go for my brush, I always turn this on. It's very important for me to see where this is. There is just a whole other class on this. This kind of, when I go here, I'm going to reset. All right. So now if I want, I can take the exposure up. I can lower the contrast down here. See that? And if I wanted to, and this is my last thing, and I'll open it up for questions. How about if I make another one here? This is the first time I'm processing this. I like what's happening. I like the warmth here. I don't like it on my keyboard. Well, okay. Then I'm just going to do a quick brush over here. And I'm going to take, and I like to turn this on, which is the same thing as the letter O on the keyboard, because I want to see, and I could go wider. I can always erase it. I do this quickly, so I want to say, oh, good, fine, Bob. Let's keep working at it, you know? Or just say, no, that's enough. And if I do that, I'll just take the set. Oh, first of all, let me reset this. I don't know why that holds in the back. And if I go to the saturation, see that? And I can get a back keyboard. Then I'll go to my erase. And if you want to have the auto mask, then you can very easily. Do I have the flow on here? I never use the flow. Oop. Okay, so you can see how I clean this off here. And I got my mask. The before and after, huh? The backslash key. That's because, that's good. No, it's over. It's over. Let's just have lots of questions. Yes.
Yes. My understanding is that you the optical exposure is like 99% of the brightness.
The optimum exposure is having the brightest subject in your scene. Now, you know, if I'm looking at you and his white badge is brighter than your white badge, I'm taking a picture of you. Don't forget, it doesn't have to be the whitest cloud if I don't take it. So you take the brightest area. If you had a spot meter, a simple test, you could place it. We don't. Yeah.
You don't let it flip, even if it's just like tiny speck, and you
don't yeah.
Even if it's like a little speck.
Okay, his question was the cat's eye. Listen, if it's a glisten in the cat's eye, if it's a reflection, a specular reflection, don't meter on that. Meter on the green eye, or you know what I'm saying, whatever's the brightest part. That's why I said that Adobe picture that had the red on the A, geez, it's just white. No one's, it's a zone 9. White with no texture. That's close sighting after the zone system. Anyone else? Yes.
I find a lot of times when I crank the highlights down and the shadows up, it goes murky.
Yeah.
I find myself turning the contrast up. But you're saying you can turn the contrast down and bring the clarity up?
Yeah, because the clarity is not mid-tone sharpness. It's edge sharpening. And you know that when we had a soft picture, we try to get a little contrasty gray paper to make it look a little sharper. And it looks a little snappy. I find more robust. And if you bring the exposure down too much and you bring the highlights down, don't forget to take that white up until you see it. The white is stretching it back to the point. But yeah, I can't tell you how many times I take down my contrast and then bring up the clarity and you see. And, you know, you always have that ability to do with the shadows, or if there was nothing else here. If I love this table, this may be a little too much saturation. I put a brush over here, just like it would dodge and burn in the darkroom, and I have so much detail. You see what I'm saying? The importance of that optimum exposure is the detail that you have, the data you have. And when you start moving that clarity slider up or the sharpen slider, you're going to say, how come this isn't chipping like I'm used to seeing it? Because it's the algorithms, the adaptive algorithms are doing magic there. You know, Jeff Shuley has a book on the print. He talks about using that detail panel like I've never seen anybody use it before. Noise removal is kind of like softening the image. So if he needs to bring something up, he'll put a selective brush and sharpen till it hurts. And then he will start using the luminosity to soften. So he's getting crisp edges and he's softening the crisp. He's the student. I mean, he's the teacher. He's some interesting things. So yeah, you do it that way, you know. Other questions back there?
Yeah, I can see how white and white and rabbit and normal everyday shots like this but the black cat, the black background, I just can't wrap my head around how you pull that back into a normal exposure.
Well, I have a good friend, Bill Wenzel, who says, Bob, you're confusing me. I mean, he knows. He's a great printer. He puts his whites at 242 because it matches his print. I have trouble trying to, why you want to get it to 99% or, you know, 242 or something like that. And I say, Bill, he says, you want me to be a believer? You want me to be a disciple? I said, no, I want you to put the finger through the hole. Why don't you try it and then call me up? I don't know what I can tell you because logically it does. It says, no, no, no. You know what I mean? And you do it. I guess I need to put some testimonials, people saying, I've been shooting for 10 years. How come I didn't know this? The results are better. So, you know, one of the things I didn't even go into was on the tone curves. Because when you have a flat subject and you bring it down and you put a little clarity and you need a little more punch. I wouldn't do it with the contrast. I go to the tone curves and go from that linear to the medium to the strong, I think it is, but then you can bend your own. But I think you'll find here that when you start using that adjustment brush, and oh, by the way, for those people who don't have Lightroom 6, you have to see this wonderful tool that just finally came out. If I do something like this, let me hit this reset, and let me take the exposure down. Now, let's say you like the exposure in the back, but what the hell is happening on your monitor? It's not credible. Let me get into Lightroom. Well, look at what this now has. The gradient and the radial now have a brush. So I can take this brush, go to erase, turn on my highlight, and take this gradient tool. That's the price of admission. Well, there you go. And I thought the exposure stuff was good. Yeah, well, you know, they had it in the last version of Photoshop CC 2014. And I said, I think I might have asked Ben the last time, why isn't it in Lightroom? When is it coming? It wasn't working in Photoshop. Now they get it working. So what I'm saying is I find myself with a brush here, a gradient tool here, a radial here, and every time I'm working with the best data I can. And that's all Ansel Adams and all of these people who control the exposure. I mean, the badge of merit, because you can make a black cat black. It's not a good thing. You know, you didn't want to overexpose your black and white negative. You blocked up the shadows. So you made it as thin as you could. And then you would expose it under the paper. Minimum exposure, maximum black, because too much exposure from the enlarger blocked up everything. This is the perpetual latent image. I'm telling you, images that I shot in 2009 like this. Now with 2012, I'm opening them up and getting so much more detail with 2012, the adaptive technology. It is pretty, pretty impressive. I keep saying, you know, Ansel Adams is with, and Edward Weston, obviously they're around here, but these guys, they not only would have loved digital photography, they're trying to figure out how to get out of the grave to jump on Lightroom 6, you know, Lightroom 6. This is pretty amazing stuff. Adams did this with water baths. We have adaptive technology. A couple of questions. Where did I put the book? This last book. And well, you know, the only thing I can say is Lightroom HDR in Panorama, guys, it's now you don't have to go to Photoshop. Not only don't you have to go to Photoshop, it's stitching it together as a camera raw. You can do your exposure and your lighting afterwards. I will probably not amend, but add to it the fact that if I have a blown highlight, like the white parrot's top of the head that I was taking care of my granddaughter's snowflake while they were on vacation, I took a picture. I think I'll just grab all three images and say, what the hell? Because you only need HDR if the dynamic range is beyond the range of your sensor. Yeah, way in the back. The cameras that, do they support exposure to the right in the camera? I'm not familiar with it. However, every camera supports exposure to the right. Just go EV plus two, you know, it's exposure to the right. You know, if somebody has a good way of doing it, you know, like multi-grade paper that adjusted itself, I guess you can do that, but I'm not aware of it. But if it works, the exposure to the right is, you know, almost the craziest thing that I've seen is Sony people here with zebras in the back. the camera, they have zebras, and other manufacturers have lines that show you where it goes over the edge of the histogram. And you know what? On the menu, you can say, let these lines come at 99% brightness. That's it. Forget the book. Just buy the camera. Oh, wait a minute. Wait a minute. It only does it on the video, but when I go to the still, you mean to tell me you don't let me adjust my, you know, this camera can do this in a heartbeat. Michael Whiteman has been, Luminous Landscape has been, you know, if he can't make it happen with Sony, he says they give it to us in the same damn camera. You go into the video mode, you can say, let my whites be 80, 90, 95, 99%. And you switch to still, they take that away. Until enough people say you're out of your mind and separate the difference. Yeah. Yes. There you go. Thanks for the questions. What was that again? Stacking. Yes. Well, up on the site for the book, the One Zone, there is free downloads, and there is a it'll be the library filter. It'll come under here. When you go into the library mode and you have these filters, see this ozone, delete level one, unflagged. This is level two. For people who flag them with a P but don't star them, I have a good friend, Frederica, Freddie. She says, I don't want the ones that I didn't like. I don't want the ones I don't use. I just want my pics with stars on them. I don't want to look back. I don't want to edit them again. I don't want to look back 4 years from now. So, and then this one here, I think just goes ahead and puts X's as a reject for all us nervous Nellies who want to say, now, before I do that, let me look at them again and make sure I didn't collect anything else. So that's downloadable from the One Zone Photo site. There is a support page. We still got 10 minutes. We're doing fine here. So I got time for questions are a little bit. On the support page, let me go here. If you go to our page and write that down, I'm sorry, I forgot the B, but it is San Francisco, San Francisco Bay, Lightroom. Okay, I did put it in there. Wow, do I have two of them? But anyways, you'll go up there and find it. When you go to here, this is the page for the book. And you'll notice it says One Zone Support. In One Zone Support, there are training videos that talks about this stacking, moving to the front, One Zone downloads, the Lightroom Develop presets, the Lightroom Library filters. Just leave your name and download them. Okay? It reminds me of one more thing on our page that I want to bring this up. The article, the four phases, look at that. Maybe we'll get back together. I do one-on-one training online. Check this out. I want to show you one more thing that I have here, and I'll talk about this. Look at this. This is the color checker. You expose this color checker and run it through the software with Lightroom. And it will produce a profile for your sensor. So when people say, you know, Bob, when you expose like that, I'm not sure my yellows look like the yellows I remember my yellows to look like. Well, you might have been happy that day. Because if you were sad today, the yellows are not looking, you know, the attitude has a color. It's a very tricky thing. However, if I was to do this here, under camera calibration, is Adobe default. Once you make a calibration with your camera, Lightroom will know your model number. And if you have two cameras, it'll go to the proper camera. If I go to Cancun, it doesn't matter, they all the one in Boston. Watch the colors here. Did you see the colors change? That's the difference. This is one of my better ideas of all time here. Taking this up and going to Boston. look at the blue. Obviously, my chip is having serious problems with blues. You see that? When you were in the dark room, all you people who raised your hand, when you brought the temperature up on your developer, did you do your finger or did you have a thermometer? Did it matter to you that it was 68 or 79 or whatever it was? You bet it did. And how about your agitation? How much did you agitate it? 5 seconds every 30 seconds? Or was it contrast? You did a water bath? How can you import your file into Lightroom with a chip that has a blue bias to it and tell me that your yellows aren't like your other yellows because your optimum exposure made them? Look at Kodachrome had crossover. Kodachrome had green shadows and red highlights. This will take care of it. Does anybody even have any idea? Anybody just see this for the first time tonight? Anybody see this for the first time tonight? Here, take this. Siconic in X-Rite gave me you, and I'll tell you what I want you to do though. I should have asked this first, but I gave it to you already. 2 weeks from tonight, I'll be back in Boston. I don't know where you're going to be, but I would love to have an online meetup here, May 12th, 6:45. The talk starts at 7. It's up on our site. My counterpart, my good guy, John, sent me the code this afternoon. If you're interested, please sign up. I don't see a send button here. So if you can't sign up tonight, I'll be back home Wednesday. But what I'd like to try to do is do this online meetup. I will go over this. And X-Rite gave me, Siconic, I have two free things to give away. I would love to think that we could do some of these meetups from coast to coast. I have one May 10th in Chennai, India. It'll be Saturday at midnight in Boston. I'll be queuing up 25 to 40 people in a room in Chennai, India, doing this online meetup. I'm giving this talk. So, does everybody understand? Am I talking too fast? Didn't I say Pacific Standard? Oh, Pacific Standard Time. It'll be 10 o'clock my time, 7 o'clock. I figured if you can make it here at 7, you can just, I'll send you an email just beforehand, just subscribe up into here, and if that doesn't work, send me an email. You can just join on your tablet or your phone. And it's going to be live, so I'm going to open it up for Q&A afterwards and answer questions. It's using Zoom. It's pretty nice. I should say Adobe Connect. Yes? No, Siconic. Siconic X-Rite color passports. There has been a breakup with X-Rite and the Mac group. X-Rite is sold, color checkers are sold individually now. There was a choice between either doing them both, Amazon and the distributor, and the distributor said, no, you're not doing it through Amazon, we don't lose our margin. You just do it through us. And they said, no, we're going to do it through Amazon. So they left them. But Siconic has kept, the one I just passed out has a gray card in it. It's different than the one that X-Rite does. So it's X-Rite Siconic. But they will have not given up my light meter, the L758. Okay, you know what? I'll hang around for a bit. I see there's a few more questions. What I'd like to try to do here is, if you'll indulge me, because we'll just end off with this slideshow. It's running live on this new, and I think this is the one. And it is Lightroom CC that now has these pan and zoom effects. So let this run for 3 minutes. We'll end it, and then I'll hang around for a few more minutes while until Ben pushes me out. Let me just run this here and see what happens. I'll try the volume. Oh, there is the data on here.
May God bless and keep you always.
F-stop, ISO.
May your wishes all come true. May you always do for others and let others do for you. May you build a ladder to the stars and climb on every rung. May you stay.
Lights. Well, thank you. That was nice. Thank you. I appreciate